Okay, today we are going to see dynamic loading in beams using some strain energy or the formation energy and conservation of energy and many of the principles that you have already seen in physics. I have here the Tux, the famous Tux, this penguin that appears in all my videos of mechanics of materials in Spanish. It's very famous. It's known even in Spain, Australia, Germany, and they send him greetings. And here's on a simply supported beam. You can see the roller there, and then we have here the pin support, and this is a beam, and maybe the deformation is already visible. But we are going to see what is the difference between this, that is called a static loading, when you put the loads, and all the beams that you have solved so far in your courses are static, and the big difference when the loading is applied in a dynamic way. Okay, it's not the same. You all remember when you were kids and your parents or maybe your grandmother was telling you or advising you not to jump on the bed. You remember? You were forbidden to jump on the bed. And they would tell you, you could break it. And you know it, even by instinct, that the bed could break. But why? With the jumping of maybe a kid of 8 years old, is breaking, and not with the weight of two adults lying on the bed statically. And you also know, when you are heavy as me, that when you are sitting on a chair and you are not sure that it's going to stand your weight, you start going slowly until you sit. So you apply the load in a static or quasi-static way. But if you just arrive rushing and sitting and depositing your weight all at once, it could even be a dynamic loading and maybe you break it. Now, we will see today the equations and what happens when a load is applied in a dynamic way. That is, for instance, this weight is not just statically deposited or placed on the beam, like this Tux. Sorry, the Tux doesn't want to stay in the beam, he's afraid. But now I'm going to drop it, and you will see the change in the deflection, the deformation of the beam, okay? Just a simple hey, and you tell me if you see the notice the difference in deflection. We can see it, that it's much larger, the deflection. And that's what we are going to see today. Sorry, I moved the camera and place it here. While I place the beam, I move the beam and I place the camera. Let us imagine that the applications that this thing could have. Okay? Maybe designing something that is going to stand some sort of jumping, stadium stands, or maybe the floor in a house. In a university, there was a problem, I think, in Florida. Was it Florida? I don't remember. But there was a party of college students, all of them heavier than me because they were part of the American football team. And they were having these kind of welcome parties at the beginning of the year. And suddenly, there's even a video, they are dancing, and suddenly the floor collapses and they all go like, phew. Have you seen the video? It was on Facebook last year. You can check floor collapse university students party, and then you will find it. This dynamic loading case. Now, let me go. I'm here, sorry if I disappear, but I'm placing my computer. But today doesn't have much battery, so I need to be a bit farther away. Okay, right here, now, let me go to the course. Just a second, just a second, just a second. That's the video?
Yeah.
Sorry. Okay, we're almost ready. Just let me see why this thing's not here. I think that will be fine. Okay, we are going to see energy methods. And just let me see the presentation opening. And there we go. Strain energy in beams. For that, we will apply some energy concepts, for instance, conservation of energy and so on. And we start with an element. Usually we take an element, an infinitesimal element, in which we know that if we have certain force applied to an area, for instance, the area defined by dx and dy, here, we have certain force applied in that direction, we will have the stress defined by this. So therefore, the differential force in that direction is equal to this one times the area. Okay? That's what is expressed here. Okay? If we apply the force gradually, I mean in a quasi-static way, that's not dynamic at all, but so from zero to value P or F, then we can consider this as a quasi-static problem, or what we have been seeing so far. Static loading, then we can define that the formation is equal to this, or the change in dimensions, delta z, like this. Then we can find the work done by this force, like this, as the area under the displacement times the force. We have here force, displacement. We have something like this, and the work is the area under this, is the area of a triangle, that's why it's one half of this. Okay? If we substitute the value of the force, we get this, and the value of the displacement, we get this. Therefore, this is a formula for the work done by the force in this element. This is standard physics, you learn this probably in your first year physics. You remember the definition of work from physics?
From physics.
You didn't come yesterday, did you?
No.
Okay. What is your what is your excuse? He said he overslept. You? If we may know, is there something we don't have to know? Don't say it. You know the reason.
No?
So why are you laughing? You are guessing. You are guessing.
Yeah, yeah. Things happen, you know.
You didn't hear the alarm clock or what?
No.
Me neither, but my dogs woke me up. Okay. So this is work. And you know, we talk about work in physics. Okay. But now, here we're talking about elastic bodies, things that get deformed. Okay. If we only have uniaxial normal stress sigma, acting on a specified direction, the strain energy that we are defining as this is given by this integral in the volume, sigma times epsilon divided by 2, differential of volume. If the material is behaving linear elastically, then by Hooke's law, you remember Hooke's law in one dimension, we get this relationship. Therefore, if the material is behaving linear elastically, this is our formula to express the strain energy in terms of the normal stress, okay, for axial loading. Yeah. So we have a cube. Where's my cube? It's in every one. Here. We apply loading. It gets a deformation when it's in tension. And therefore, we can find the strain energy when we are applying that force The strain energy is like the force or the energy stored in a battery. This elastic body is having some energy stored there because there's a force deforming it. So when we remove the force, what is going to do that strain energy? Bring it back to zero deformation. It's stored there, like in a spring. You deform the spring, remove the force, it goes back to the non-deformed shape. Okay? The same for elastic bodies. In the case of axial stress, it's like that. Now we are going to see what happens to beams, things like this, when we apply bending. Okay, you see, I apply bending, the thing deforms. I remove bending, thing goes back to straight line. So there's also energy stored there when we apply bending. Okay. Now, this is difficult to understand sometimes to people who are not engineers, because they might think that if you design a machine or something with a beam, that this thing should not be deformed. Especially cases like, extreme cases like earthquakes, I had even some engineers saying that why the buildings collapse or why there were damages to structures. And the thing is here, linear elastic behavior. You cannot design buildings, especially in places like Mexico City, to remain intact without any damage after a strong earthquake. It's not economical, it's not what the code is requiring you to do. Actually, sometimes the damage in the structure dissipates the energy, okay? But if it's controlled. You want the structure not to collapse, that's a different thing, but doesn't mean that it will not have damage. It's like when you have an accident in your car, or you hit another car, or you get damaged in the car, but you are fine. And you have seen photos of cars completely destroyed, and the driver is fine. Because this kind of thing is desired, that the formation somehow transforms the energy, the kinetic energy of the impact in the formation. Okay, but now we are talking about linear elastic bodies. Now let's talk about bending. In the case of bending, let us consider this beam, like this, and then we apply bending, this is the moment M, and we consider here, this is the centroid, and you know what happens in the centroid of a beam? I just mentioned it 2 days ago, how is it called, this axis?
Neutral axis.
Neutral axis, there are no deformations, therefore there are no deformations, there are no stresses. We consider an element that is a distance y from the centroidal axis, with an area dA, okay? And there's a stress there, in that direction, due to bending. Okay? So, when we apply bending, some fibers will have, or most of the fibers of the beam, just the one, the neutral axis, will not have stresses, but the rest they will have. And the farther you go from the neutral axis, the higher the stress. Why? Because you remember the formula for bending, stress is something like this. Yes. It's a value of sigma acting in that direction. Okay? And some fibers are in tension and some in compression. Now we apply the same principle. The differential of volume is dA times dx. The elastic strain energy in the beam is therefore this. We had this formula before. So it's an axial stress. But we substitute the value of sigma, this one, we put it there, and it's a square. And we do some algebra thing here, we get this y square, what else? Well, that's only y square. And we group it with the dA, that is the volume, times dx, dA times dA, dx is the volume. And this is something you learn in statics, that is the inertia moment, I. So you have here I squared, and you get one I here, you cancel one, and you end up with this formula. And this is the formula for beams. This is the elastic strain energy in a beam. The integral from 0 to L of the moment times dx divided by 2 e I. Okay? Questions? No? What are we going to do? Now we are going to find, in some examples, the strain energy in some beams, standard beams. And after, we will apply it using conservation of energy to waves falling on a beam. Dynamic loading. Okay. Let's see the first example. I'm using the examples provided by Hibbler's book, so you can go and buy the book, by the way. We have a cantilever beam. Imagine this. This uniformly distributed load, W, and you are all able to find the equation of moments for this beam. We make a section here. We get the internal forces M and the shear force V. Then we have uniformly distributed load in the shape of a rectangle concentrated in the middle of the distance x, like Wx. And we get the equation of moments like this. And this is our equation of moments. We substitute it in the formula. Integral from 0 to L, m squared dx to EI. And we get this. You have to solve a simple definite integral here. And finally, this is the result for the strain energy, elastic strain energy, in a cantilever beam with uniformly distributed loading. Standard for me. This is starting from the left, going to the right. Any questions? There's an alternative procedure starting from the right and going to the left. Different kind of section, different formula, obviously, for the moment, but they show here that you arrive to the same result as before. This value is important because this is telling you how much energy, elastic energy, is stored in a beam when you apply a bending moment, okay? Or loading. In this case, it's in terms of the uniformly distributed loading W. Another beam. Now we have an overhanging beam with a force applied P here, and we have two intervals here. We can clearly find the values of the reactions like this using statics, equilibrium, and then we can find the strain energy using first the first interval of the beam. We get the value of the moment as this, is the reaction here, times the distance x1, is called for the first interval, and then we go from 0 to L, this is the value of N, standard formula, we get this. Okay? Any questions? No? Now, we have the second interval, we have x2, I'm going from the right here, you see. We get another value of the strain energy. Now this is for the second interval. Okay? We have already found one for the first one. And now this is for the second one. Okay? There's a note here, important note. This and the previous example indicate that the strain energy for the beam can be computed using any suitable x coordinate. It is only necessary to integrate over the range of the coordinate where the internal energy is to be determined. So, this is it. I had an activity here for you, but we are going to go two beams to find the strain energy. If you are watching, you can stop the video and try to find the strain energy for these beams. Otherwise, let us proceed to the solution. But if you want to do it yourself, just pause the video and then check this. Are the reactions? P divided by 2, P divided by 2. And then we have this formula, M squared. What is the value of M? We make the same section, P divided by 2. P divided by 2 times X is the moment. We substitute it in the formula for, what is the formula? This one, M squared Px. By 2EI, okay? And then we get the value here of P squared L cubic divided by 96 EI. Okay? No big deal. Second example. Sorry if I go fast, but you can check this in your textbook. Now we have concentrated moment at the end. So the beam is when I do this, concentrated moment. Okay. So the formula for the moment is a constant equal to m0. And then we get to the strain energy equal to m0L. This is the result to EI. Okay. No big deal, finally the strain energy. And you may say, why do I need this strain energy? Now we are going to go to application. Okay. Imagine you are working now for a company designing these barriers that can be considered like beams. And you need to see what happens when a car hits it. But the car is coming with kinetic energy and with a mass that is hitting this certain amount of energy. So these things need to be strong enough not to be just removed by the car when it hits, but not so stiff or hard so that they damage people in the car. It has to deform. Okay? That's what is the purpose, to deform when this thing hits, when the car hits. There are other barriers, like this one for in train stations, to stop any car just moving. Stop it there. Even in some parking lots on upper levels, they have these barriers. Otherwise, and there have been accidents, and there are videos all over the place on Facebook when this thing falls. And also, if you are dealing with car crash tests, you can also do some computation. But obviously, when we are in these cases, we are not going to deal with the deformation of these cars, because that's non-elastic range. We are talking about these things to remain elastic. Okay? Because remember, the strain energy that we have seen so far is for elastic behavior of the material. Okay? Now, if any of you have a small car, very, very small car, like Smart? No? I don't want to hurt your feelings. The next one. Okay? We were talking about this yesterday. Okay. In the US, I understand, correct me if I'm wrong in the comments, there are some cars that are forbidden to go in the motorway, on the freeway. Why? Because they might not be visible for trucks, and maybe they are not safe enough in the case of a collision with big trucks, you know? Anyway, these kind of studies can give you the foundations of the studies leading to a PhD or things like that. Now we are going to talk about dynamic load. We need conservation of energy, and we are talking about the strain energy. There are other types of energy like potential energy and kinetic energy that you learn in dynamics. Do you remember that? The principle of work and energy, no? From dynamics, chapter 18, Keebler's book, no? It's fascinating, those topics. Now, I have a video here. Let me see if it opens something. I hope the link is active. Let me see. Okay. My computer react because it's slow today. And the mosquitoes are killing me. Anyway, let me see. Now we are fritos. It's coming, don't worry. I'm close. There we go. Yes, it's available. Just let me move it to this window.
Because this is a link that I put place there many years ago.
And let's try to see the cracks. Yeah. This is a car hitting a barrier. And what happens to the pool domain?
Is that azul?
More or less. I cover here the nationality of the car. I don't want to hurt any feelings, but this is a thing so many years ago. And let me remove it.
Those people might get offended. Now in this time of millennials, people get offended by everything.
So what happened to the dummy? Some comments in this video say, dummy rests in peace. Look.
Oh, no,
he's going to heaven. And the designers are going to hell. Sorry. Of the car. Look. A lot of damage there. And yesterday we were talking about premium cars, why they cost so much money. Probably because they have a lot of engineering behind, kind of things that not all the car companies can afford, or may not have the experience and knowledge to design safer cars. Okay? That's what you pay when you get a premium car. You are sure you're not going to get something that deforms like this in a car crash. And this is 64 kilometers per hour. I don't know if you noticed there was a label on the bonnet of the car saying 64 kilometers per hour. That's 40 miles per hour. And to deform like this at 40 miles per hour is really nothing you were expecting. We have some cars like that still being sold in Mexico. This is something bad because it's not protecting anyone. Okay, let's go back to strain energy and dynamic loading, impact loading now. Let us take a block falling on a spring from a high edge. What happens? When we say that the work done by this spring has to be equal to the potential energy of the block. What is the potential energy of the block with respect to the deformed shape of the spring? You remember from dynamics, from physics, is mg, that's the weight, times what?
H
total, in this case is h plus delta max. Okay? This is just potential energy. Yes or no? Now we are going to equal that to the work done by the spring force. What is the spring force? This one, force in the spring. And we have seen that we have something like this, delta times force, something, the area gives us the work done by the force. Okay? Please tell me if the camera is still recording. Mm-hmm. Red light?
Yeah.
So we equal the energies, the work done, with the potential energy, and we get this. And everything is expressed in terms of delta max, that is the maximum deformation of the spring, when I leave this block fall on it. And I get, guess what? Quadratic equation. And you know from secondary school how to solve a quadratic equation. How many roots do we get?
Two roots.
Obviously you are not going to take the negative one. You take the positive one because it makes sense in engineering. Okay? I know that your maths teachers or physics teachers might even, probably physics ones know, but the mathematicians, yes, might say the negative one is an answer. But here in engineering courses, we need to remember what makes sense in the real world. So it's the positive square root, and this is it. If we substitute, what is the delta max? Well, we have something here. W divided by k. What is that? You don't see it? We have a spring. Imagine a spring like this. And I put a weight here. And it's going to deform something, isn't it? Yes or not?
Yes.
And then you learn this in dynamics. This is the deformed shape. So this thing we call it, we put it, place it statically, and then it deforms. Then this is the deformation by the weight. We call it the delta static. See it? Before we apply any external force. Yes or no?
Yes.
You suffer with dynamics?
Yes.
So, and this spring is got a constant k. And we say that the force in the spring equals the weight. And this is k times delta. What is the value of delta st? W divided by k. Yes or no? And this is what you have here. So we can even simplify this and say delta st equals W divided by k, and rearrange the equation, it gets like this, then you can put delta st outside, and you have the delta max in the spring as the delta static, just if we were placing the cube of the weight statically, times something. And this is a factor of amplification. And it's obvious that for any h, even if h is equal to zero, what happens? What's the result of this equation?
One.
Of the radical, yeah? Mm-hmm. This is zero, then you get the square root of one is one, plus one.
Huh?
Two. So if h is equal to zero, but we're applying the law dynamically, what is the deformation compared to the static deformation when we place the load? It's the double. Okay? If I sit all of a sudden in a chair, it's like applying all my weight in an instant with h equal to zero. The effect will be like twice the deformation as if I start going slowly. That's the mathematical explanation of this effect when you go to, you are just trying something new. Imagine your friends from industrial design design a nice fancy chair that you are not very confident that it's going to work well, so you start sitting. See, it might break, it might break. You apply statically your weight. But if you arrive running and you sit, all of a sudden, maybe the deformation is twice. Okay? This is what is written here. The delta max is twice when h equals zero to the static one, when we apply the load dynamically. Now we're going to apply this to beams. We will not have springs, but beams. You have solved in the previous days beams using finite elements. By remembering this formula, you can, with finite elements, you might get the delta static. And using, something like this, you might get what is the dynamic effect of an impact load on a beam. We will see that later. Let us solve first another type of problem involving conservation of energy. Now imagine this is a small car, whatever, hitting a spring with a speed V, or a velocity V. What is the energy that this thing is carrying? Kinetic energy. Okay. So this is kinetic. 1/2 of the mass times the velocity squared. Yeah? And we equal it to the maximum deformation of the spring. This is the work done by the spring force when it's deformed. we can get from here the delta max equal to this. And you see, depends on the velocity and on the spring also. But we remember this, that is from here. And we have here the same term. So we can put it like this, in terms of delta still static. Question? It's very nice to apply now concepts from dynamics, from physics, to mechanics of materials. Now we're going to see some more complicated examples, because so far we have dealt with springs, but now we are going to deal with beams. That is the topic of, the main topic of this course. Okay. Some notes. The results of this simplified analysis can be used to determine both the approximate deflection and the stress developed in a deformable member, like a beam, when it's subjected to impact. Even some design codes, for instance, when you're designing bridges here in Mexico, at least when I studied, there was something to consider the impact loading, like when a car enters quickly into a bridge. It's not the same as when you enter slowly. And you can experience that in any of the bridges here, that when the traffic is slow or is completely stopped and you are in the middle of a bridge. It happens here in the river Atoyac. You are in your car here. And then on the other lane, in the other direction, the cars are passing fast. When they pass fast, then you feel this in your car. You are inside the car and you feel this. When the cars pass slowly, you might not feel the same effect. So, impact or dynamic loading. Okay. We need to remember that the structural elements remain elastic, in an elastic behavior. Now we are going to see different problems using the analogy of the spring. And it's very easy. Now let's talk about axial loading. For instance, this column, where I'm going to let a block like this fall on a column. We know from mechanics of materials that the delta for any axial loading problem is PL times divided by AE. You remember that? The delta, the deformation. We call this the delta static, using the same analogy as here. And this thing was equal to what? So, read what happened there. I tell you, when it's not the camera, this is a course on this course. Just give me a second. Let's see. There we go. It's coming back to life, sorry. Okay. Now, something is happening. Maybe my computer is possessed by the spirit of laziness.
So am I. By Timochenko.
Yeah. We will pass this. This. We were here. Now, instead of weight, we have force P. Make an analogy there. So we substitute P divided by K. But we know that this is equal to this. PL divided by AE. So I can cancel the P's and I get this. When I isolate or solve for K, I get what? This. AE divided by M, okay? This is the equivalent of the stiffness. If the column was a spring, I could calculate the spring constant like this. Because okay. It's behaving elastically, the material. And you see the area, the cross-section, the elastic modulus, and the length. They all interact to give me the value of K. Okay? Okay, so using that, we can find what is the deformation delta max when I release this from a height h using the solution I just showed you for a spring. The same for beams. We have a beam, and then release a block from a certain height h, and I can go to tables in the book and find the delta max, sorry, the delta static, and you will find it like this in at the back of your mechanics of materials books, like this for a beam. This is the midpoint deflection, 48 EI. This is on the standard formula, and it's in tables at the back of books, and it comes from solving the Bernoulli equation and x equals L divided by 2. Okay? So we substitute that as delta static here, but we know that this is equal to P divided by K from that problem. So I get equivalent K like this for a beam with a concentrated load in the middle of the span. And with this, I can find the delta max using the solution for a spring, okay? Using the delta static. Okay? Using what? Using this formula for N, where N is the impact factor. Even if H is equal to 0, you know that this is going to be N equals to 2, but we need to substitute here the delta static as well. So let us solve a problem for you to see really the big difference it makes to release a load from a certain head. Okay. First problem, axial loading. Okay. The aluminium pipe is used to support a load of 150 kilopounds. Okay. Determine the maximum displacement at the top of the pipe if the load E is applied gradually, that is as usual, as we are used to, and then suddenly by releasing it from the top of the pipe at h equals 0. Take the elastic body of aluminium 10 to the third KSI. Very strange units they use here. This is like 10 to the 4 KSI. Okay. And assume that the aluminium behaves elastically. So we use the solutions we have for spring. We have the elastic behavior of this material. We have the conservation of energy. In this case, we have what? The work done by the, or the potential energy of this thing. Let me identify, because I don't manage to see. Okay, this is the static one is PL divided by AE, like in mechanics of materials, yes. And this is the strain energy in the column, using the standard formula, the integral from 0 to L, sigma x divided by dx divided by 2AB. Okay? We have seen at the beginning of the presentation. And this is the work done by the deformation of this thing, of the force in the column. So we solve the elastic or static deformation. We get 0.028 inches. And then we apply the equation we have just seen for the impact factor using h equals 0. This one. Substituting obviously the value of delta static. And we get, look. We had a delta static, and we call it big, 0.02083 inches. And now, just releasing the weight without any height, h equals 0, we are getting the double of the deformation, delta max. Okay? And this is something to take into account, because it's like an impact, releasing the weight all of a sudden. Okay? Now let's talk about a beam, because this is the topic of this course, beams. We are going to deal with an impact on a beam. We have a weight, and we are going to release it from 2 inches, something like this. It's an 836 steel beam, and it's a commercial shape, W10 by 39. Determine the maximum bending stress in the beam. This is mechanics of materials. And the beam's maximum deflection is the weight, 1.5 kilopounds. is dropped from a height of 2 inches onto the beam. Elastic modulus, the standard elastic modulus for steel, 29 to the 6 psi, okay, or 29 times 10 to the 3 psi. We apply the equation for a load in the middle of a beam. This is some tables at the back of the mechanics of materials books. PL cubic divided by 48EI. In this case, P is equal to the weight. This is the static. If the load was applied in the middle, statically, we get this deformation. But now we have H equals to 2 inches. We substitute this here and here. And instead of having 0.0365, we get almost 9 times the deformation. You see, 9 times. Just by applying the load, 2 inches. 2 inches is nothing. Imagine you as a kid jumping on a bed, maybe 10 inches or 12 inches. That's why the bed will break with the deformation. Okay? And the stresses. Now we are going to find the stresses. Okay? This is the deformation using dynamic load with a block falling from 2 inches onto the beam. Now, the deflection is caused by an equivalent static load, P max. We need to find now this P max. How? We need to find the equivalent load that could provoke the same deflection. Okay. Now we have sigma maximum here. We know the value that it should get by the moment. We have here the moment max. What is the moment max? When we are at L divided by 2, and we know that if we have a simply supported beam like this with a P max here, each reaction is going to be P max divided by 2. You agree? This is in the middle, L divided by 2, L divided by 2. Then what is the moment here? I want to know the moment here is this times L divided by 2. Moment maximum, P max divided by 2 times L divided by 2. So we get here the P max. Where is it? Why is this happening here? Why is the elastic going to happen? This one here. Yeah. This is the maximum, and just the same we got here. What is C? Is half the depth of the beam. Okay. We go to tables to get the inertia moment. We go to tables to get C because it's a commercial shape. And we get this. 12 because we are converting there. This is C from the tables. Delta max, we already found it. And we are also using this formula. Sorry. We substitute, we get P from here. We have delta static equals P L cubic 48 EI. So we get P, if we are using P max here, the next slide, we get delta static times 48 EI divided by L cubic. That's what is replaced there. Okay. And making some algebra, we get to this. And this is the stress, 19.7 KSI. And we compare this, you know, we know that the material is an A36 steel. It means that it's got a yield stress of 36 KSI. We compare this to 36 material still behaving elastic. Still recording, sorry?
Yep.
Yes? Okay. Well, this is a beam. Now we are going to design something moving. Okay, here's just some algebra finding P max in terms of delta static or delta max and so on. Okie dokie. Now we have a railroad car moving with this speed very slowly, 0.2 meters per second, and it's going to hit something here, like a barrier, with some dimensions there. We barely see them. When it strikes a steel 200 millimeters by 200 millimeters post, if the post is fixed to the ground at 6, determine the maximum horizontal displacement at the top. So it's like a cantilever beam, but this thing is going to hit it here, like this, P. And we want to know what is the maximum displacement here at the top. We will find first the displacement here, and then we will do some calculations. From tables again, we get this. Delta max equals P L cubic divided by 3EI for cantilever beams. A is the point of contact, and here B is the top. Okay. This is the formula for A. From here we get P max, like this. Then we use kinetic energy on this side, we equal to the work done by this force performing. But we know that the delta max is given by this. We substitute here, and we get this equation is quadratic. Get the value of delta max at A, like this. But this is not the delta max at B. Okay. We need to find at B using some sort of relationship, that is next. But this is the value, substituting all the values, we get this 11.6 millimeters here at 8. But then we can find the value of P max, like this. From the same formula from beams, we now solve for P, and we get this value of P. It's equivalent P, producing the same deformation. Okay. Now, using some slope deflection formulas, also on tables at the back of the mechanics of materials beam, they give you the slope. Theta, it's called theta, but it's the slope. This is a standard formula at the back of mechanics of materials books. Once we have the equivalent P producing this deflection, we can find the deflection here at the top, like the deflection here, plus the slope times this length, AB. Okay? That's what we apply here with this. This has the displacement. Well, this, yes. We had 23.2 millimeters instead of 11.6. Basically, we had seen, we had done a regla de tres, as we say in Mexico, we had the same one. Okay, these are some examples for impact loadings in elastic beams. Now, I leave you with this problem. Please solve it here as well. Try to solve it, please. This is an activity for you. And with this, I stop the video, and you have some minutes to solve it. Please. Okie dokie.